Hey, this is Kevin from Smooth On. We're here in the concrete shop today to show you a project that we worked on recently for an expansion of our concrete testing area. We're going to make a 12-foot post-tension table. Now there's many different ways to go about it, but we're going to show you some of the tips and tricks that we use to make the table. I hope you enjoy the project.
Post-tensioning is a technique used to internally reinforce concrete. Generally, cables are used in larger structural applications, but for our smaller piece, we are using threaded rod. These rods run inside the concrete through a conduit, and then they are tightened after the concrete is allowed to cure for a short period of time. The threaded rod is anchored at the ends of the table, and once they are tightened, they put tension on the entire piece, allowing it to withstand much greater loads. We wanted to have lots of space underneath to store bins of raw material. Our lab counter was going to be 12 foot long, and we did not want any visible seams in the top or the sides. We had a large enough casting bed for the top, but we needed to combine lengths of melamine for the front drop face wall. In order to make it seamless, we used a roll of laminate to cover both sections of melamine. Spray adhesive was applied and the laminate was pressed on. Make sure to work out any air bubbles to ensure a smooth finish. We then trimmed the laminate to the exact size of the mold walls. A straight line was snapped on the casting table, and that would serve as a reference for attaching our mold walls. To preserve the surface of the large casting table, we used double-sided tape to help adhere the mold walls to the table. Once we had our reference, we laid out the rest of the counter. We next laid out our side walls. Since this is a post-tension piece, we needed to determine where the threaded rod would go after our piece was cast. Our conduit for the threaded rod would be encased in GFRC, so we laid out the shape of what those ribs would look like. We drilled holes in the sidewalls that would help suspend our conduit while casting. We taped off the top portion so we will have a clean edge to work with after we spray our face coat. The thickness of our counter, minus the ribs, is going to be 3/4 inch thick. We use that same thickness for a back mold wall. This will serve as a reference when we are applying the backer. Additional blocks of melamine are glued to the table to help ensure that the walls don't move when we're casting. We also used a guide to make sure that the entire table remains square. Once our mold walls were laid out and attached, we applied a paste wax to our casting table and buffed out minor swirls and scratches. Sonite wax is applied to all the corners before caulking. For a more detailed explanation of our caulking process, please check out some of our other videos. We cut our conduit lengths as well as the scrim before we begin mixing concrete. We place paper around the perimeter of the mold. This helps keep the casting table clean during the high spray face coats and also saves some time. Now the piece is ready to be cast. We used our Forton VF-774 mix design. We wanted as much flexibility in the counter as possible and wanted a high polymer loading. We batched out all the materials and used our column mixer, double paddle mixer, to mix the face coats. We'll be using various shades of blue for the entire process. There are a lot of other really great benefits to using 774 for this project. It helps create a tighter, denser cured piece. This will contribute to the long-term durability of the counter. It also helps eliminate crazing and spider cracking. With such a long span, this is really important to maintaining the look and integrity of the piece. Another benefit is the complete dispersion of pigment due to the uniform particle size. We really want the various shades of blue to stand out. And finally, PCI compliance. Forton VF-774 complies with Appendix G of Manual 130. This governs quality GFRC cladding, and if it excels in those strenuous environments, it will certainly be a benefit to our project. We'll be using the high spray technique. The idea behind this high spray technique is to keep the gun high off the casting surface for the first few passes. We don't want to completely cover the mold. additional pigment is added to the mix, and then that is also sprayed on the mold surface. Finally, more pigment is added, and the dark blue concrete is sprayed on. We ensure no areas are missed and that the mold face is completely covered. This creates a lot of depth in the final casting, and many different finishes can be achieved with this technique. We allow the face coat to partially set up. Then we batch the same mix design and begin blending it. Since this pigment is relatively expensive, we cut down on the pigment loading for the backer coat. Our backer coat is where most of the reinforcement is coming from. We used a 3/4 inch AR glass at a 3% loading by weight for this mix. We apply the backer in multiple thin coats. This cuts down on the amount of entrapped air in the backer and therefore makes the piece stronger. We also use bubble busters or compaction rollers to remove the air and properly arrange the fibers. A wooden darby and float are used to ensure the backer is evenly placed. Finally, we screed the back to ensure a uniform thickness. We are now ready for the conduit that will hold the threaded rod. We remove the tape on the sides, giving us a clean edge to work with. A length of continuous scrim was placed in the backside. Using scrim on a counter like this is always a good idea. The backer mix was allowed to stiffen up and made it ideal for encapsulating the conduit as well as building up the drop edge. We were careful to maintain the conduit at the same height through the entire length of the counter. This drop edge will ultimately accomplish a few things. It will hide the ribs that house the conduit and threaded rod, provide additional support for the 12-foot span, and ultimately enhance the look of the counter. Once we were done casting, we covered the counter with plastic and packing blankets and left them there overnight. Good curing practices are crucial in a project like this. The next day, we remove the curing blankets. Before we demolded the counter, we ground the bottom of the drop edge so that it's flush with the mold walls. This creates a really smooth surface and prevents the face coat from chipping. Now it's time to demold. The piece is still relatively new and flexible. We really want to be careful when handling it at this point. We use shims to elevate the piece and release it from the casting surface. The piece was transferred to a processing cart and flipped over. Even at this point, you can really see how the shades of blue add a lot of depth to the counter. One of the risks with the high spray technique is the potential to entrap small air pockets in the face coats. To eliminate any air bubbles, we lightly wet polish the entire piece with a 200 grit diamond pad. This opens up any voids that might be right below the surface. We then use bone paste and the same blue pigment to create a slurry. This slurry is then worked into any of the small voids by hand. A drywall knife was then used to strike off any excess material. The bone paste is allowed to cure overnight. The piece is then wet polished again with a 200 grit diamond pad to remove the excess bone paste. Buddy Rhodes diamond hand pads are used to touch up the edges. These work great for this small detail work. The piece is allowed to completely dry before we seal it. The piece is finally sealed with a solvent-based acrylic. Since this counter was going to be used heavily, we chose this option because it is easy to repair and reapply. It also really enhances the color. Now it's time to install the threaded rod. We were really glad that we took the time to keep the conduit as straight as possible when we were casting. We used a metal plate on each of the ends of the counter. It adds a cool finish, but more importantly, distributes the load evenly once we tighten the threaded rod. Once both were in place, we tightened the threaded rod, putting tension on the entire counter. We then cut off the excess threaded rod. We fabricated two custom supports for the counter. Our custom fabricated supports were then attached to the wall with concrete anchors. Now the moment of truth. It's time to install it. This new workspace not only looks great, but provides a great working area and plenty of open space below for raw material storage. We really hope that you enjoyed this video and hope that you picked up a few tips and tricks that you'll be able to use in your future projects.